Good morning, everybody. As you may already know, there has been an arrest in the Maya Millete case. Her husband, Larry, was arrested yesterday and charged with her murder. They are still searching for Maya's body. Her family has been out searching nonstop since January the 7th when she was reported missing. And they're going to continue to search until they find her. But I wanted to play this news conference from yesterday because I know on a lot of other channels it was a little hard to hear, but I think I found a good one here and we can hear it. And there's some information in here that I find rather disturbing and interesting. So I just wanted to kind of bring that out for everybody. So let's go ahead and get into that, and then we will discuss it a little bit afterward.
All right, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Lieutenant Dan Peake from the Chula Vista Police Department, and I oversee our Criminal Investigations Division. Thank you all for coming on such short notice today. Before we get into the press conference, I want to recognize a few individuals that are here. Of course, I want to recognize the mayor of the city of Chula Vista, Mary Casillas Salas. Also wanted to recognize the city manager for the city of Chula Vista, Maria Cachadorian. And also wanted to recognize City of Chula Vista Council Member Jill Galvez. Before we get started in the press conference, I wanted to let you know that there'll be two speakers. The first speaker will be the Chula Vista Police Department Police Chief Roxanna Kennedy. And the second speaker will be the San Diego County District Attorney Summer Steffen. I also wanted to recognize several individuals that are to my left. That helped make this investigation possible and lead to the ultimate arrest that took place earlier today. And that would be FBI from San Diego, Special Agent in Charge, Suzanne Turner. And also from the United States Marshals Service, Supervisor Deputy Marshal Paul Bill. And then of course, I wanted to recognize May's family, which are all to my right here. And May's sister, Mary Chris, will be saying a few words today, and she'll be representing May's family. With that, I'd like to introduce the Chula Vista Police Chief, Roxanna Kennedy. Thank you.
Thank you. Good afternoon. As Lieutenant Peake mentioned, my name is Roxanna Kennedy. I'm the Chief of Police for the Chula Vista Police Department. And I want to first thank everyone for attending today's press conference with such short notice. Along with our law enforcement leaders, I am joined today by May Millete's family, her friends, and our community members. Today at 11:42 a.m., the Chula Vista Police Department SWAT team served an arrest warrant and arrested Larry Millete for the murder of his wife. Larry was taken into custody at his home and was alone at the time of his arrest. And I know many of you are all very concerned about May's children. I want you to know that May was first reported missing to the Chula Vista Police Department shortly before midnight on January 9th, 2021. May was last seen 2 days earlier by family members at her residence located in East Chula Vista. Since being notified of May's disappearance, officers and investigators have remained committed and committed to determining the circumstances behind her disappearance. As the scope and complexity of the investigation grew, so did the size and the scope of the investigative effort. The Chula Vista Police Department began a formal partnership with a multi-agency working group, including the San Diego District Attorney's Office, the FBI, and NCIS. The primary goal was to bring May home to her family or bring justice to the persons or person responsible for her disappearance. To date, the investigation has included over 67 search warrants, 87 interviews, review and investigation of over 130 tips, and thousands of hours of methodical investigative efforts. These efforts ultimately generated a variety of pieces of evidence that have become clear and overwhelming. Larry Millete, May's husband, is responsible for May's murder and disappearance. Today is a step towards justice, but it does not mark the end of our investigation. The Chula Vista Police Department will continue to seek answers for her family. Today is about May, and I'd like to tell you a little bit about her. May was loved by her family and friends and was committed to her children. May's murder and disappearance has impacted so many over the past 9 months, including many people who had never even met May. Yet they rallied around her family and helped keep May's disappearance in the spotlight. While understandably the family and public want answers, our investigative team must follow the facts and the evidence that has led us to today. Our team did not stop. They relentlessly pursued justice. They wanted nothing more than to find out what happened to May, and as we now know, to hold her killer accountable. Homicide detectives say that they speak for victims who cannot speak for themselves. Their mission is one of compassion for victims and victim families. They are dedicated to being able to bring closure and accountability to those involved in these tragic events. This case will ultimately be placed in the hands of a jury who will be given the chance to evaluate all the evidence and the facts. While we are here to report the arrest of Larry Millete, nothing will change the fact that May's murder is a senseless tragedy. A mother is gone. A family is broken, and a community is left with questions and confusion. This affects us all, but it affects most of all those who loved and cared for May. Today, you will notice that officers and family members are wearing purple ribbons. It is not lost on any of us that October is Domestic Violence Awareness Month. Domestic violence is prevalent in every community and affects all people, regardless of age, socioeconomic status, sexual orientation, gender, race, religion, or nationality. This is a time to acknowledge domestic violence survivors and be a voice for its victims. I would like to thank my entire team at the Chula Vista Police Department that you all see around you, along with our partners, the District Attorney's Office and DA Summer Steffen, FBI San Diego and Special Agent in charge, Suzanne Turner, U.S. Marshals, San Diego Division, and Supervisor Deputy Marshal Paul Beal. And unfortunately, they couldn't be here today, but San Diego NCIS and Special Agent in charge, Josh Flowers. I'd also like to give a special thank you to the Cold Case Foundation, who also helped through this process. Their support of all these partners and their commitment has been invaluable to this case. I would also like to thank the many volunteers and community members who are here today. Thank you. You've been there the whole time to support May's family, and we appreciate it. And to May's family, I want you to know that I pray every day that we find May and we get closer to your family. I'd now like to introduce our district attorney, Summer Steffen.
God entered into my body like a body my same size, like me floating into you and you floating into me. Let's see.
Sorry, guys. I didn't know there was an ad right there, but I got it.
Thank you, Chief Kennedy. I'm Summer Stephan, San Diego County's District Attorney. On Monday, October 18th, yesterday, my office filed a criminal case in San Diego County Superior Court charging Larry Millete with the murder of. Specifically, count one alleges that Larry Millete unlawfully killed May on or about January 7th of 2021. In violation of Penal Code Section 187. There's also a second charge of illegal possession of an assault weapon. Following his arrest today, the defendant was booked into jail and is being held without bail. He is scheduled to be arraigned this Thursday at 1:30 in the afternoon at the South Bay Courthouse. Whenever one of our community goes missing, we hope for their safe return. I know that is what May's family wanted. Sometimes missing person cases remain unsolved, but as the evidence unfolded in this case, meticulously and carefully block by block, it pointed in one direction, that May was murdered. As we make this announcement, I know the hearts of the community are broken, as are the hearts of May's family. I wish we had better news for them. The only thing that we can do in the face of this senseless violence is to bring justice, to work tirelessly to make sure that we cannot bring May back, but that we can bring justice. And that's what it's about. As we make this announcement, understand that there's going to be questions about the fact that May's body is still missing. California law, and similar to across the nation, is very clear that the murder charges, that we can file murder charges despite not having a body. In fact, the law is so crystal clear that we cannot let someone murder someone and gain a benefit by hiding the body in a way that we can't discover it. In fact, there is case law that we will be using in this case that makes it even more clear that a missing body is circumstantial evidence that there was foul play. And that it's a murder, because somebody who takes their own life cannot hide their own body. We filed this case based on the evidence that was developed during an extensive 9-month investigation. Chief Kennedy and her team left no stone unturned. I am so proud.
Y'all pay attention right here, because this is the really important information that we need to discuss.
Members that put everything on the line to help bring May home, and in the absence of that, to find who killed her. Chief Kennedy called on my office to assist. The answer was a resounding yes. I assembled an elite team that includes a homicide prosecutor, a district attorney investigator, a cold case homicide investigator, and a crime intelligence analyst, to name a few. We had one goal in mind. We worked hand in hand with Chula Vista Police Department to turn over every stone to solve this case. I have to pause and thank the DA team that are here with me today, the essential team voting on this case, and will continue this fight for justice going forward in the courtroom of law. Our homicide prosecutor, Christy Bowles, back here, our lead district attorney investigator, James Rhodes, and our cold case homicide investigator, Matt Grindley, along with our crime intelligence analyst, Peter Villafour, who you will learn was able to uncover some key evidence. with the support of Chief Deputy District Attorney Tracy Pryor and Commander Eric Nava. Thanks so much that San Diego shined as it always does with collaboration with the FBI, U.S. Marshal, NCIS joining us as they have whenever there was a call to duty. I'm going to provide a brief synopsis of the evidence. Understand that a lot of the evidence cannot be shared. It will be shared in the courtroom. However, there is an unsealed portion of the arrest warrants that includes evidence that would not compromise additional investigation. This case, the investigation in this case, while we know that Larry Millete is responsible for the murder, is ongoing, and bringing May home to have a proper burial for her family is ongoing. So what you will get is the things that will not compromise a jury trial. One of the main reasons I'm providing this is that now that Larry Millete has been arrested and is being held on no bail, it is our experience that there are people out there that often have information, but they feel uncomfortable, they feel worried, they feel scared, they have loyalties, and they don't come forward until an arrest is made. We've experienced that repeatedly. We are hopeful that now is the time that you come forward if you have any information. We also know more facts now that might help somebody who saw the vehicle that we believe was the transport vehicle that was used to dispose of May's body to search their memories and understand from what I'm going to describe that there is no specific location and that the radius may be very vast and large. So it can be someone in the county, somebody outside our county. That's why we appreciate the media attention that hopefully will allow someone to see this and think, I did see Alexis pulled off the road somewhere on January 8th of 2021, and to call us and provide that peace to the family of May. The investigators found, and when I say the investigators, I mean Chula Vista Police Department, working with the DA's office, working with our partners, that starting in 2020 and continuing until January 7 of 2021, May wanted a divorce for many reasons. Her husband, Larry, did not want the divorce. May was committed to her three young children. They were the center of her life. She wanted to continue being a parent, and she tried to negotiate that they can be parents to their children, but not subject the children to a toxic relationship. But Larry would not have it. In homicide cases, there's often a triggering event. In this case, on January 7 of 2021, May was no longer talking about divorce. She took that step, and the last call recorded that May made was to a divorce attorney. She did not make any further calls. When she called the divorce attorney on January 7, we know that Larry was aware because he sent text messages that were screenshot to his boss that let him know that this was final, that it was coming. It also turns out, and this is from extensive search warrants, everything is done by the book. Extensive search warrants that were done by Chula Vista Police Department with the help of our team that uncovered a trail of things that were happening that were of great concern. Larry was trying to hold on to May, and he resorted to contacting what are called spellcasters. I've never had a case where that was involved. These spellcasters would be asked to make May want to stay in the relationship. But as December of 2020 came, those messages to spellcasters were a lot more threatening. He was asking for May to become incapacitated, for May to be in an accident, to have broken bones so that she could stay at home, thus displaying his homicidal ideations to harm May. The January 7th date was very clear. She not only had called a divorce lawyer, but she had set an appointment for January 12th to meet with the divorce lawyer in order to carry out the divorce. She wanted that date and not Friday, January 7th, because their daughter had a birthday that she had planned. And again, the kids were the center of her world. And she did not want to do anything to disrupt that birthday that was going to take place on January 10. The last text message that May sent was on January 7 at 8:15 p.m. to her family. She sent that on Facebook Messenger. That's another set of warrants that were done. In the afternoon of January 7, Larry Millete sent a really telling text. He said, "I think she wants me to snap, and I'm shaking inside, ready to snap." At 9:21 p.m. on January 7th, Larry screenshot from his account cryptocurrency amounts of money that were in his cryptocurrency to his two daughters, ages 11 and 9. May's phone activity stopped on January 8th at 1:25 a.m. On January 9th, Larry Milletti's spellcaster messages that had been sent on a daily basis turned from May to wanting to punish a man that he blames for the failed relationship. This was before Merrick Kreese had called the police about May being missing. Now we go to November 8th. Security video brought by, retained by Chula Vista PD, showed the defendant on January 8th at 5:58 a.m. in the morning, moving his Lexus GX460, a black Lexus, with the license plate that bears the name Melani. The Lexus was already backed into the driveway, but Larry Millete repositioned that Lexus where the back of the Lexus is in the entrance of that garage. He repositioned it where no video camera can capture whether a body was put in the back of the Lexus or not. But based on that positioning, we're not able to see that vantage point. At 6:45 a.m., after repositioning the car at 5:58 a.m., Larry leaves and he does not return to the house for 11 hours and 21 minutes. He leaves his phone behind so that there is no ability to track the GPS or location on the phone. He takes his four-year-old and leaves the two older children at home. When asked by investigators, he said that he went to Solana Beach for 11 hours and 20 minutes. at the temperature that January 7th is. When shown a map, he pointed to the Torrey Pines Beach, which is 4 miles away from the Solano Beach. On that date, his employer was calling frantically, January 8th. He even called May, saying, "This is not like Larry not to show up to work," and wondering where Larry was. His father called, checking where he is, but no response. The phone was not operating. On January 26th, detectives served the search warrant to seize the contents of the Lexus's infotainment system. This is an older 2015 Lexus, so it doesn't have the capacity that we have today. The report generated from the download indicates a navigation event on January 8th at 3:29 p.m. in the afternoon for Larry's home address, 2413 Paseo Los Gatos. So 2.5 hours before returning to the home, he is entering his home address to get to the home. And this is why I am giving this information, so the public understands that we do not have a vicinity where the body may be. It may be out 2.5 hours or even further or closer. And that's why we need the public's help. Also, Larry's messages that were captured in the search warrant showed that he was informing his boss that she's serious and is going to get the divorce. Larry's father even texted him saying, "Larry, please turn on your phone. This is January 8th because your boss is calling regarding your job." When a search warrant was served at the residence, they were looking for firearms registered to Larry. Despite a court order, he had not turned over one of those weapons, a 40 caliber gun, and it remains outstanding to today. So again, I tell the public, if you are holding on to that weapon, this is the time to turn it over to police. Detectives also obtained security footage from the neighboring residence and observed the following. On January 7th at approximately 9:57 p.m., the sound of 9 loud bangs were recorded. Unfortunately, despite the excellent work of the FBI, they were not able to confirm whether those were gunshots based on the quality of the recording, but we truly appreciate their efforts and their continued efforts. But at 10:34 p.m., neighbors heard the children, the Millete children, playing in the backyard at 10:34 p.m. on January 7th. This was unusual because of the time of night. On the evening of January 8th, May's brother went to the house around 6:30 p.m. By now, Larry had returned. When he arrived to the residence, he was worried about May because they had not heard from her, and May was always in contact on her phone. He went up to her room and knocked on the door, and there was no response. And then he went out to the street and looked in her room and did not see any lights. Larry first told the brother that he was at work and doesn't know what May is doing. This is January 8th. And then he said that he changed the story and said he went to the beach with the four-year-old. It's important to note that it was not Larry that called the police to say that May was missing. It was Mary Priest who went to the house, knowing her sister is always in touch and that her sister was looking forward to the birthday in Big Bear, who called the police. Part of a nobody investigation is to look for proof of life. And in this case, for 9 months, there is no proof of life that May is alive. Case law is clear that in today's world of finances and everything being tracked, that shows no proof of life. May excelled at her job. She was committed to her career. She loved her children. She was looking forward to a birthday that was coming up that she had planned. And after January 7th at 8:15 p.m. in the evening, that was her last communication to anyone via text, social media, or phone call. The team also looked at all of the finances, and while she had a savings account and she was making a decent living, there was no withdrawal from any account, not before, not during. All her valuables were left in the house. All four cars are accounted for. But a key piece of evidence was, where was May's phone? Because being able to track that phone gives you a really important piece of the story. And after an extensive recreation and experiment that was done in September of 2021, it was clear that May's phone was in that San Miguel Ranch neighborhood, at her home or thereabouts. That means that May did not leave, did not go anywhere. She always had her phone. I talked about the financial evidence, which is very, very important. This arrest would not have been possible without the tremendous efforts of Chula Vista Police Department Chief Roxana Kennedy and her team. And I also, again, want to thank my team for working hand in hand with the Chula Vista Police Department. We asked the public at this point to call with any tips with regard to a Lexus GX460 black license plate Milani. If you saw that vehicle anytime on January 8th, please call and report that information. If you have any information about the missing 40 caliber gun, please call and report that information. If you have any evidence at all that you're aware of, please call and provide that information. While this arrest and the filing of charges starts us down the path of justice, this is not a win. We've lost a life, and all we can do is pursue justice fairly in order to bring justice to this family. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief Kennedy and San Diego County District Attorney Summer Steffen. At this point, I'm gonna ask Mary Chris, who's the spokesperson for May and May's family, to come up, and she's gonna provide a few words. Thank you, Mary Chris.
Thank you. I would want to say thank you, everyone, for being here today, for all your support. Of course, I want to thank Chula Vista Police Department for relentlessly working on my sister's case to this point. Chief Roxana Kennedy, thank you so much. You tell us you're praying for my sister. That means a lot to us. The DA's office, thank you so much. Summers, Stephen, thank you so much. And all your team, thank you. They tell us they've been working hard, day and night, working on my sister's case, even though we don't see it. But they're working hard to hopefully to get to this point. It's been 9 months. And also with the community support, we were able to do it. Sorry, it is just overwhelming at this time for me. I'm still trying to take it today. It's been really hard. He's a family. He's our family. It's hard to go against a family. He's been with us for 20 years. My sister did love him. She gave him 3 kids. She just can't let go. And this is still not the end. We're still have a long way to go. We're still asking the public, please help us bring my sister home.
We will, my Grace.
I still want to see my sister.
We're here.
I still want her to come home to us, please. If you know anything at all, please help us. We are pleading. I still want her to come home. We did a promise to her 11-year-old daughter that we will bring her mom home, please. Let the kids know where their mommy is at. Let them know the truth, that they'll still be brought up.
And that she didn't abandon them.
Healthy.
She didn't just get up and leave. I also want to thank the media for never giving up on the family.
Yes.
On Maya's case. You guys put her face on all the television's newscasts, social media. You guys never gave up on this. And you guys didn't let this case become a cold case. Just like the police department. Thank you, everybody. Men and women in blue. We love you guys.
Thank you.
The community that supported us every weekend, every week. Prayers. Every Thursday we do prayers. Thank you to all the community that came out. And every search.
Even weekdays.
Rain, shine, desert, ticks and all.
Yeah.
We were out there searching for our sister. So.
We're not going anywhere.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you. And again, thank you so much, everyone. It's all a teamwork from everybody. Thank you. We are bringing justice to my sister, and we'll bring her home. Thank you.
So thank you to Mary Chris and Richard. Like it's been mentioned several times, this is an active and ongoing investigation. We still do not have May's body. And somebody out there may have saw something, or they may know exactly where she is. That person can remain anonymous. They could report it to Crime Stoppers, or they could call the Chula Vista Police Department or the District Attorney's Office. And please provide that information. All it could take is one tip, one lead to lead us to where May's body is. With that, I will open it up to a few questions. If they are specific to the District Attorney's Office, let me know. If they're specific to the Chula Vista Police Department, I'll be happy to try to answer that.
I have a question for Summer, please. Summer, I realize that you're not going to talk in depth about the evidence, but can you tell us the guns that were confiscated and the other things taken from the house? Does any of that constitute physical evidence that points you to their neglect? Or is this just largely a circumstantial case?
Yeah, I can't talk about the evidence, but it is a case that's built on a piece by piece circumstantial evidence.
Concern you in the process of prosecuting?
No, we've prosecuted several missing body cases. Fortunately, in one of them recently, the body was discovered right before the trial. We're hoping that that happens, really, to bring finality to the family. But we feel very confident about the prosecution and the evidence that we have.
District Attorney, are you able to seek the death penalty without a body? And I have a
follow-up. Not related to whether you have a body or not. It's related to whether we have a special circumstance. Right now, the charges are murder, There is not an alleged special circumstance. A special circumstance is something like the murder was committed in the course of a robbery or a kidnap or rape. Those are things that constitute a special circumstance. Maybe some evidence will develop of a special circumstance, but at this point we have a murder.
And would it be a mitigating factor in Larry Fleck's favor to Peter to reveal their
We always want to know where the body is, and we hope that anybody with good conscience will allow May's family and her children to have a burial place to visit their mother.
Are you saying the person in the South Portland area talking? Is he talking?
Okay, thank you. Yeah, so there, unfortunately, this is an active and ongoing investigation. There is a lot of questions that we can't answer. We obviously want to protect the case, like the Chief Kennedy and District Attorney Summer Stefanitz said, this is going to go in front of a jury. At that point, the case will be laid out to a jury. So until that happens, there's a lot of questions that you have that we are not able to provide you answers with today, just due to the fact that this is ultimately going to in front of a jury and will be tried there. Is there any questions specific to the Chula Vista Police Department before we wrap it up? I'll be right with you, ma'am.
First of all, Lieutenant, will the children be released to Maya's family? Are they going to be okay?
So all I can report is that the children are safe, and I can tell you that this afternoon when Larry was taken into custody for the murder of May, the children were the number one thoughts in our mind to do that safely, to make sure they were never in danger. And once we knew that the children were not in danger, that's when the SWAT team moved and took them into custody. There's one question right here.
Yeah, should we still be searching the cell phone thing triangulation area?
So early on in the investigation, it was released to the media, also to May's family, that we had reason to believe that May's phone may have been in the area of the old golf course near her house. When that information was released, we were going on the best info at that time. At this point, we've been able to analyze that data more closely, and we feel that that May's phone never left the residence. I have one more question.
Do you have search location for Larry's family members? Do you have search in location for Larry's family members who live? Do you have reason to believe that his family members helped him in any way?
At this point in the investigation, the only person that we feel is responsible for May's disappearance and murder is Larry Millete. That'll be all. Thank you.
Okay, so that was the police department update in its entirety, as it played out yesterday afternoon. There's a lot of stuff in there to unpack. The first thought in my head, I keep going back to, what is this spellcaster thing? Like, that to me is major red flags. Like something is not... That would have been the first thing to tip them off that something is not right there. And I'm glad that they realized that. And thank you to the Chula Vista Police Department, FBI, and everybody that was working on this case. They have done a really great job. And my heart goes out to Maya's family, to Mary, Chris, and Richard, and the children. I can't imagine what they're feeling right now, when they woke up this morning to not only have lost their mother 9 months ago, but now they don't have a father. And it's so heartbreaking to me. I know that Mary, Chris, and Richard and the rest of the family have got to be beyond excited that he is finally locked up. He's finally been arrested for this. And they're facing that they're going to get some justice on it from that end. But at the same time, I feel like that's kind of diluted by the fact that they still don't have Maya. And they need that. They've got to find her. They've got to get that closure to know that she can be laid to rest properly like she deserves, and that the full truth can come out. And I don't know. I don't know how anybody can take another person's life, but to do something like that with the children there, that's even a whole nother level. And the fact that wasn't lost on me that they did say when Larry left the house on January the 8th, that he had the four-year-old with him. If he's going to dispose of Maya's body, God, it's so hard for me to even say those words out of my mouth. I can't even, okay. Excuse me. I'm going to try to get through this. This is really emotional. But if he's going to dispose of Maya's body, then you've got to think what things did that child see with that child, the four-year-old being with him? They had to have seen something. Or what kind of things has he said to them, to any of the children? And I really hope that now that he is out of the picture, they can get a specialist in to interview these children and just see what they've seen, what they've heard, what they know. Maybe they can get some answers on that end of it. If I understood correctly, the oldest child is 11 years old. That would definitely make that child old enough to be able to articulate what they've seen, what they've heard, that kind of thing. So hopefully they can get some help there. And I know that Mary Chris and Richard and the family are not going to give up searching for Maya, and we're not either. We're not going to give up. We stand with you, Mary Chris and Richard and family. We stand behind you 100%. And we're not going to give up either. We're going to continue to do everything we can to help in any way that we can until this thing is completely done. So if you can at all, go visit the website that is on the bottom of your screen right here, thehelpfindmaya.com. You can donate to Mary, Chris, and Richard for their search efforts. And, you know, in case you didn't know, I don't know how much people know about this case, but Mary, Chris, and Richard, Mary, Chris is Maya's sister, and Richard is her husband, the sister's husband. And they have uprooted their entire lives for the last 9 months to go out and search for Maya on their own. The family has rallied together and they go out every weekend and search. Every free moment, every opportunity, they are out there searching. They're walking miles and miles of just everywhere they can possibly go to look for her. They've got people out there walking around. They've got drones. They've got cameras. They've got every resource they could possibly pull together to be out there searching for Maya. And they've been doing this for the past 9 months. Mary Chris gave up her job to go and dedicate all of her time to searching for her sister. There's so many things that they have missed. They've missed birthdays with Maya's children, and because Larry has taken that from them. But now that he is in jail, he's in custody. There's no bail, so he's not getting out. He's going to have to sit there. And I'm really praying that the longer he sits there, I hope the more time he has to actually think about it and let it sink in what he has done. What he done to Maya, what he done to her family, what he done to his own children. Because that really needs to eat away at him until he can't absolutely take it no more and he comes out and lets them know where she's at. At this point, he needs to just give it up because this is not going to go away. It's not going to go away. He can deny it all he wants, but we know what happened. We know the facts. And they would not have taken this long to build this case and to go in and arrest him if they did not think they could make this case stick in court. And I'm hoping and I'm praying that he please just, if there's any ounce of decency left in that man at all, just give it up. If you don't do it for Maya, do it for the kids. Do it for your children. Your children deserve that closure. They didn't deserve to go through this. And it is totally selfish and ridiculous and disgusting that you would put your own children through this. When it was not, you know, the whole domestic violence thing too, because this is Domestic Violence Awareness Month, but I don't understand what is wrong with our society when so many men, and then it's not always men. I can't say that because, you know, men can be victims of domestic violence too. It doesn't matter, man, woman, young, old, whatever. Whatever kind of relationship you have, you can be a victim of domestic violence. But I don't understand why anyone, rather than allowing somebody to just walk away and just let them go, why would you choose to end their life? What point is that proven? What good is that doing besides hurting everybody around them? And ultimately, you're hurting yourself because you're going to end up in prison for the rest of your life. Or you're going to end up locked up on death row. You know, I don't get it. There is this big stigma around divorce. And there's a lot of people that, you know, they look down on people because they're divorced, you know. And in a way, I get it, but in the reality sense of it, I don't understand it at all. There is no shame in walking away. It happens. It's part of life. But why would you put your children through that? Why would you put your children through not knowing what happened to their mother? And from what I've gathered, and I don't know this 100% for fact, because I've not heard it, as they say, directly from the horse's mouth. But from what I gather, Larry has been telling the children that their mother just left them, that she just packed up and went away. And that, no, why would you do that? Why would you traumatize your own children just because your relationship wasn't working out anymore? Just because your marriage wasn't working out, you're going to traumatize your children and take the whole family down with you? That's so selfish and disgusting. And I hope you rot in jail, Larry. That's exactly where you need to be. I hope you are uncomfortable and miserable every minute of every day while you sit in there and rot for the things that you have done. It is just too much. It is totally disgusting. And I hope that the children are going to be able to get the help that they need and be able to be reunited with Mary Chris and Richard and the rest of Maya's family, where they can feel safe and they can feel loved and they can know the truth that their mother did not abandon them. That she would never do that. I don't understand people's mindset. I don't understand why people's mind, some people, their mind just instantly goes to that dark place. I don't get it, but we've seen it before in a lot of other cases. I mean, I could sit here and lame them off for you, but I'm sure you all already know them. We've seen it before. We know what the outcomes are for all of those cases, and I'm really putting my faith in the fact that it's going to be the same for this one. He's going to be locked up where he belongs, and Maya is going to be able to be brought home to be given the proper funeral and respect that she deserves. She deserves that, even if it takes another 9 months, and I pray to God that it don't. Hopefully somebody, now that Larry is locked away, somebody is going to speak up and somebody's going to say something. I don't know. I don't know how Mary, Chris, and Richard and the rest of the family do it. They have got to be the strongest family that I've ever seen. Like I said, my heart and my prayers go out to them and the children, and we're going to keep on top of this, and we're not giving up. We're going to find Maya. We're going to help bring her home, and we're going to do what we've got to do for Mary, Chris, and Richard and the rest of the family. If any of you know what that whole spellcaster thing is all about, could you leave me a comment down below this video? Because I'd really like to discuss that some more. I've really thought about jumping in and doing some Google searching on it, but yeah, I don't want that search history on my computer, and I don't want that bad vibes. So, but if anybody can just give me a little brief overview of like what is, I mean, is that like some kind of witchcraft or like some kind of black magic type stuff, or is it satanic or what it is? I've seen it before. I mean, I've seen scammers posting stuff. You see it all the time on Facebook. They'll be posting things like that, but I've never actually looked into what it is. I usually just, you know, delete those people and move on because I'm like, that's kind of weird and creepy, you know, but it is what it is. And no offense to anybody, if you honestly believe that stuff, everybody's free to believe what they want to believe. It's just my personal opinion that stuff is weird and creepy. But if that's your thing, you know, you do you, boo-boo. It's okay. You go ahead. That was pretty much all we had for today on Maya. I think I've been here for like an hour now, a little over an hour. So then I'm going to go ahead and wrap this up before you get sick of the sound of my voice. And I thank you all for being here. And again, if you can help donate to the search to help find Maya, just visit their website, helpfindmaya.com. There is a button on there for you to donate. You can donate through PayPal. You can go directly to that website and it will link you to all of that information. And also they do have a GoFundMe that is, it is under Help Find Maya. I will link that in the description box down below so that everybody can get to that too. You can also donate through there, but I don't really like the GoFundMes because that company takes a certain percent. So all of the money that you donate is not going to the family. I understand they have to run a business too, but I would rather give the full amount that I'm trying to give directly to the family rather than have it going through a corporation. But to each their own, if you choose to go that route, like I said, I'll put it in the description down below and you can have that. And again, if you see anything, if you've heard anything, if you're out in that area, please contact the Chula Vista Police Department or the FBI and give them that information because we have to bring Maya home. And don't forget to subscribe and ring the bell and like this video so you can see my next ones that I put out. And we're going to keep on top of this case. And we have several more cases that we're going to be doing a little bit more deep diving into in the near future. And I love you all and have a great day.